So in the last videos, we have talked about phototropism, which is a plant's tendency to grow toward light. There is actually auxin, a kind of plant hormones that make phototropism happen by elongating plant cells. So say if a plant senses the light coming from one direction, auxin will accumulate in the dark side of the stem. And auxin elongates those plant cells in the dark side, and the stretched plant cells push the stem towards light. So auxin is just one of many kinds of plant hormones that can affect plants' behavior and development. And today we are going to have a look at the five major types of plant hormones, including auxin, cytokines, gibberellin, abscisic acid, and finally ethylene. So when we speak about auxin in this video and in most college biology textbooks, we are actually referring to a material called endoliastic, or called IAA. IAA is generated in the apical bud of a plant and is transported from top to bottom. It can also be found in embryos with seeds in fruits. So the two major functions of auxin are, 1. It elongates plant cells, and 2. It promotes plant cells division and differentiation. So how does auxin make plant cells elongate? One hypothesis is that auxin initiates elongation by weakening cell walls. We have already seen how this elongation effect can make phototropism happen. Auxin also gives plant longer stem and root. And actually, auxin is the mechanism behind apical dominance, which is a phenomenon that a plant's main stem developed dominantly over its side stems. So now auxin's effect on prompting plant cells division gives the plant a stronger stem with wider diameters, and also it gives plant more roots, which means a better developed root system. And actually, auxin is the key fact for a fruit's development because auxin exists richly in seeds of a fruit, and it helps fruit to grow bigger. Now, as auxin makes your plant look taller, cytokines makes your plant look more bushy by prompting its cells division. So a plant with rich cytokines in it tend to get a more differentiated root system and also more auxiliary buds. Cytokines can also keep plant tissue looks young and fresh. So in commercial, people usually spray cytokines on fresh cut flowers to help them maintain the fresh look. Now let's assume that you have two identical plants kept in the same environment with the same room temperature. Whether the plant will look tall and thin or it's bushy but short depends on the balance between auxin and cytokines. So in commercial, people usually cut off a plant's apical bud where auxin is generated. So the auxin percentage in the plant will drop and the cytokines in it will be comparatively high. So you get a more bushy plant, which is a more favorable product in commercial. Cytokines is generated in a plant's root system and is conducted in a reverse direction with auxin, which is from bottom to top. So this is why we always see a triangle-shaped plant, not a reverse triangle and nor the star-shaped plant. That's because the plant is always growing horizontally in the bottom part and vertically in the apical part. And now, let's talk about gibberellin. Gibberellin can promote a plant's seeds germination, bud development, stem elongation, root development. And it's in a plant's apical bud, young leaves, root system. So yeah, you can say it's like an overall nutrition to a plant, and it's everywhere. And in commercial, gibberellin can be very useful in treating dwarf plants, and it can also produce bigger fruits by elongating those fruit stems, so each of those fruits has a bigger room to grow. And who does not like bigger fruits? But when we talk about plant hormones, it's not like the more the merrier. Actually, rice seedling with too much gibberellin in it can grow spindly and tall, and it will topple even before they can produce any grain. So far, we've been talking about growing hormones. But there is actually a kind of inhibiting hormone called abscisic acid. Abscisic acid counteracts with other growing hormones by inhibiting the plant's growing process. So abscisic acid is like a sleeping pill for plants. It can put plant seeds in sleep. It can also put a plant in sleep by closing stomata when there's lack of water in the environment. But why, you may ask, does a plant need to be put in a sleep? Well, a short version is that timing is very important for a plant's development. Say, a seed does not want to germinate in a harsh winter time, and a tree does not want to grow more leaves during a drought. But again, a plant's behavior is not determined by a type of hormone alone. For example, if a seed will germinate or not is actually depending on the counteraction of gibberellins versus abscisic acid, and that seed will only germinate when the percentage of gibberellins in it overwhelms abscisic acid. And now finally, let's talk about ethylene. Counteracting with auxin, which promotes growing process, ethylene triggers plant aging process like fruit ripening and the fallen leaves. I'm going to put A and B here. And first, let's talk about fruit ripening. The process includes breaking down of cell walls, which soften the fruits, and also a conversion from starch and acid to sugars, which sweeten the fruit. But the fact that ethylene is a form of gas under room temperature, it means that it will flow around. So if you have a bunch of apples and one of them is ripe, the ethylene it releases will ripen the rest of them one after another. And that's why people say that a rotten apple can ruin the whole batch of them. And because of the same reason, it's always a good idea to hand up the bananas you bought from the market. The point is to prevent ethylene from accumulation, instead of to fool the bananas by making them thinking that they are still growing on the tree so they won't rot. And now, let's think about falling leaves. Falling leaves are just beautiful, but why? I mean, why is it necessary for the leaves to fall? Well, the answer is that leaves are falling prevents plants from drying out in winter when roots cannot take up enough water from the frozen ground. The falling of leaves decreases transpiration from leaf surface and thus protects the plant. But I'm gonna say once more, if the leaves stay on the tree or it falls, depend on the counteraction between auxin and ethylene, in which auxin prompts the plant's growth and prevent leaves from falling, and ethylene forms abscisic layer and stimulates synthesis of enzymes that digest abscisic layer. Let me explain. Now I have a stem here painted brown, and the blue one is the protection layer, which is generated even before the leaf falls. And after the leaf falls, the protection layer will form a leaf scar, which prevents the plant from infection. And the red layer is the abscisic layer that ethylene forms, and the enzyme is eating the abscisic layer away. So when abscisic layer is thin enough, and plus the weight of the leaf itself and the blowing wind, the leaf will just fall. So when winter comes, the drop of temperature triggers the increase of ethylene, while auxin in leaves drops when the leaves age, and the ethylene becomes comparatively high in leaves, making the leaves fall. Okay, so let's draw a conclusion from today's discussion. There's many kinds of plant hormones, and we have seen five types of them. There's auxin, cytokines, gibberellin, abscisic acid, and ethylene, among which auxin elongates plant cells, results apical dominance, promotes fruit growth, and makes phototropism happen. Cytokines prompts cells division, makes plant bushy, and keep plant young and fresh. Gibberellin triggers seed germination and gives the plant longer stems. But too much gibberellin will make your plant turn yellow and tall and fruitless. Abscisic acid puts seeds and plant in sleep. And finally, ethylene controls the aging process, including fruit ripening and falling leaves. And we have also learned that it's not a single type of hormone alone, but their combined effect that determines a plant's behavior and development to better adjust itself to the changing environment. That's for today. Hope you enjoy.